Chances are, you've thrown these things in the trash without even knowing it. But if you use them like this, they'll spawn an electric arc, hot enough to melt any metal known to man and even turn rocks into lava. In this project, we're modifying a fire brick and some flashlight batteries to build an electrical arc furnace on a budget. Let's start this project with a heavy-duty lantern battery and this aluminum silicate refractory brick. The brick is 3 inches tall, 4.5 inches wide, and 9 inches long. Let's get to work making the furnace by measuring lengthwise and marking it 3 inches, 4.5 inches, and 6 inches. This is where it needs to be cut, so it's a good idea to draw perpendicular lines with something like a combination square to make it as accurate as possible. Now get a mask ready, because according to the safety sheet, silica dust is something you really don't want getting into your lungs. These refractory bricks are extremely lightweight and full of air bubbles, which is why they're so great at insulating heat. But it also means we won't need any fancy tools to cut them. A simple wood saw is all you need because the bricks are so soft. In reality, you could probably carve them out with kitchen utensils if you really needed to. I put a couple of bricks under the edges to help channel the dust and prevent the blade from scratching the table when it cut through. Okay, the three lines are cut, and you can see they separate the brick into four pieces. I designed it this way so that one fire brick will make two furnaces, effectively cutting the cost in half as well. Let's move on to carving out the reaction chamber and giving the furnace some special features. I'm using a 3/8 inch drill bit and a 2 inch Forstner bit I got at my local hardware store. The Forstner bit makes it easy to target the exact center of the brick and doesn't take much of an effort to begin chewing away at the refractory material. Drilling too fast could rip the brick apart, so let's take it slow and steady until the hole's around 2 inches deep, which should leave a 1 inch base of insulation at the bottom. Clean out the dust and you'll see we've got a nice little chamber for our reactions to take place. Now let's turn the brick on its side and use a 3/8 inch drill bit to burrow down near the top. When it penetrates into the chamber, keep going straight down into the other side, and when it pops out the bottom, gently push the bit outward to break through the wall, exposing the holes. Let's do the same thing with the front end of the furnace, except this time we're not going to go through the other side. We'll need to modify this hole by drilling inward at about a 45 degree angle until the tip of the bit meets the bottom of the chamber. If we carefully work the bit upward until it breaks loose and clean up the edges a bit, the bottom half of the furnace is finished and looks awesome. The holes on the sides are for the electrodes, and this last one has a dual purpose, for watching the reaction and pouring molten metals. Now the two smaller pieces are the lids for the furnace and should only need a very small modification. Two 3/8 inch holes drilled 1 inch from the ends and 3/4 of an inch from the sides to form a place where we can safely store the electrodes when they're glowing orange and too hot to put anywhere else. Speaking of electrodes, we're going to need carbon rods like these to strike the arc because they're the only things that'll handle the extreme temperatures. I went to a local supercenter and picked up a 2-pack of 6-volt lantern batteries for under $5. These ones are the heavy-duty kind, and don't worry if they're new or used because completely dead batteries will work just as well. Now we need to crack open the container, and my tool of choice for doing that is a pair of wire cutters. If we break the lid off the top and cut the two wires holding it on, we've got easy access to the four battery cells inside. Go ahead and snip the wires connecting the cells together, then pinch the caps in the center and gently pry them upward. With a little bit of effort, they should pop right out of the casing, and just like that, you've got a carbon electrode ready to go. But that's not all. These batteries have all kinds of fun things hiding inside. The casings on these cells are made of zinc, and they're packed with manganese dioxide. So use something like a screwdriver to scrape around the inside, pulling all that crumbly gunk out. The manganese dioxide could be saved for other experiments, but in this project, we're just interested in the carbon rods and the zinc casings. And I'm really excited because we just scavenged 8 of them. Now just for fun, I wedged the zinc battery casings in my bench vise and started cranking to see if it would make the casings a bit smaller. Apparently, you can crush them down so they're really compact, and that's great because we need them small for an experiment we're going to try in just a minute. The last thing we need to make for the mini arc furnace is a pair of adjustable stinger grips. I made a trip to the hardware store for 2 5-foot lengths of 8-gauge stranded copper wire, 2 half-inch copper couplings, number 20 stainless steel hose clamps, and 2 sets of 6-inch locking pliers. I modified the pliers by removing the rubber handle grips to expose the metal, then stripped the ends of the cables to expose the copper so they could be secured directly to the pliers with the hose clamps. Now if you put the copper couplings on the other ends of the cables and hammer them flat or clamp them with a bench vise, they make little copper lugs you can hook up to an arc welder for power, like this homemade version I put together with microwave parts. You might remember that project where we center tapped the two transformers so it could power the arc furnace on 120 volts AC. However, it works much better on 240 volts, so let's just leave it as is. Now since the electrode grips are adjustable, they can be set to bite perfectly onto any size carbon rod we need and hold them firmly in place. But there is something you need to know about these scavenged rods before you use them. The first time they make electrical contact, they're gonna catch on fire. There's some kind of wax in the rods that bursts into flames as soon as they touch, and it'll take anywhere from 20 to 30 seconds to burn it all out. It generates a lot of heat and a lot of smoke, so try to do it outside and away from anything flammable. At this point, our mini arc furnace is completely ready for operation, so let's test it out with the zinc battery casings we scavenged earlier. With one casing in the chamber, let's go ahead and set the lid in place, then power up the arc welder so the electrodes are charged and ready for action. The magic happens when the rods are pushed through the holes in the sides and suddenly bump into each other, striking a dangerous and blindingly hot arc of electricity. In less than 10 seconds, you can see the rods are already blazing hot, and amazingly, the metal is already liquefied. 8 casings later, the chamber is full of liquefied zinc, so now that it's runny, let's test out the functionality of our built-in pour spout. This is how easy it is to transfer molten metal from the mini arc furnace into makeshift ingot molds. Now, zinc has a relatively low melting point, but this furnace is resilient enough to tackle high-temperature metals like copper and even steel as well. So if you're in the mood to see glowing streams of molten copper or sparks flying around the room, look for those extreme experiments in another project video. Alright, our zinc muffin is hardened, so let's knock it out of the muffin tray with a screwdriver, then dip it into a bowl of water to quickly cool it the rest of the way. The result is a beautiful chunk of solid zinc to add to our homemade metal collection. As a word of caution, if you breathe in any of the zinc oxide fumes when melting zinc, there's a small chance of catching metal fume fever. So if you're recycling zinc yourself, be sure to wear a respirator or do your experiments outside to reduce the risk. Well, now you know how to extract carbon electrodes from old flashlight batteries and carve insulating fire bricks into custom arc reaction chambers. By the way, if you cut the brick into 3-inch blocks, you'll get 3 furnaces, and you can even modify them to hold graphite crucibles for smaller experiments. Well, that's it for now. If you like this project, perhaps you like some of my others. Check them out at thekingofrandom.com. Hey guys, thanks for watching. This has been one of my favorite projects so far, and I'd love to hear whether you liked it as well, so leave me a message in the comments. If you want to check out some of my other project videos, I recommend the ones over here on the side, and if you haven't already, please subscribe because I put out a new video every 5 days. Now, some of you have told me you're not getting notified of my new releases, so I'm going to show you how to fix that right now, but you have to be on a computer to do it. Look under this video for the subscribe button. If you're not subscribed, the button will be red, so click to subscribe, then look for a little gear icon next to it. Click the gear icon and check the 2 boxes that say send me updates and show only uploads in feed. If you're lucky enough to have a menu option, change it from occasionally to always and then click save and you're done. That's how to do it. So take 10 seconds right now to update your settings on my videos and you'll never miss an upload again. Thanks again for joining me in this project and I'll see you in the next video. Talk to you then.